Forever a Brother. Forever a Son.
And when you cry, be sure to dry your eyes.
Forever an Athlete.
Are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide.
Forever a Husband.
Don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk with pride. Don't show the hurt.
Forever a Dad.
Because the pain will soon be gone. And when you dream, dream big.
Forever a Coach.
As big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true.
Forever Norman.
When you dream, dream big. And when you dream, dream big.
Forever a Champion.
As big as the ocean blue.
Today, we honor the life, career, and legacy of longtime baseball coach John Altobelli on the one-year anniversary of his death. John Altobelli is forever a Pirate.
On January 26, 2020, a tragic helicopter crash took the lives of 9 individuals, including Orange Coast College head baseball coach John Altobelli, his wife Keri, and their daughter Alyssa. Today, 1 year later, we look back and we remember John and all that he meant for OCC, college baseball, and the countless lives that he affected positively over the years. My name is Jason Kaler. I'm the athletic director at Orange Coast College. And I'll be joined by a few other speakers from the college today, including college president, Dr. Angelica Suarez, dean of kinesiology and athletics, Dr. Michael Sutliff, head baseball coach, Nate Johnson, and our sports information director, John's brother, Tony Altobelli. When I look back and think about John, you know, it's a lot of people ask about John's legacy and his success and his championships. And one of the things that really stood out for me was how much John cared for his athletes and how much he did to try and help them out, whether it be with baseball, getting to school on a baseball scholarship or without a baseball scholarship. You know, he was dedicated to his team, and a concept that we talk about in the athletic department a lot, Pirate Family, really rang true with John and his program. I also can't help but think back to John's last state championship in 2019. Prior to the Final Four tournament, all the teams get together for a pre-tournament dinner, and the head coaches are given an opportunity to speak. And John was known for his speeches. They tended to be the highlight of the night, the entertainment of the night. But this particular year, he took a different tone. And he spoke directly to the El Camino College baseball team, who had lost one of their athletes that year, a member of their team. And he shared with them his experience of losing a player of his own 10 years earlier with the tragic passing of Jordan Watanabe. And what he shared with that team, and this has been something that I really like to, when people ask about John, I always say, I want to share his words with you. These were the words that really sat with me. Was he talked about how he often found himself noticing the number 22, Jordan's number, no matter where he looked. And so he told El Camino, you know, you'll see your teammate's number. It'll pop up more than you think. And so for us at Orange Coast College, that becomes the number 14 now for John. And so when I see the number 14, you know, it gives me an opportunity to smile and think about John and remember how great of a friend he was, how great of a coworker he was, and how great of a coach he was. He really is missed in our athletic department. I know he's missed by so many people because he truly, truly did affect so many people so positively over his life and his career as a baseball coach. So today, wherever you are, however it works for you, we all have grieved differently through this process. you know, we come together virtually to remember John, remember Keri, remember Alyssa, and celebrate their lives. Thank you.
My name is Dr. Angelica Suarez, and I serve as president of Orange Coast College. I join you today virtually as we honor the life of John Altobelli, his wife Keri, and his daughter Alyssa. I too remember that Sunday afternoon in January a year ago when we gathered on the baseball field to honor Coach Alto with you, his colleagues, his friends, current and former athletes, where you share stories about how John had impacted your life, sometimes by giving you that extra push that you needed to be successful, and other times by just being there for you and encouraging you and mentoring you. Coach Altobelli had many successes on the field, but we know what was most important for him was seeing his athletes be successful in life and in education. Coach Altobelli's legacy will continue to live on at Orange Coast College as we continue to see our athletes succeed and represent the values that were instilled in them by Coach Altobelli. John, we will miss you and know that you are forever a Pirate.
Hey everyone, I'm Andrew Cromwell, a third-year sophomore here on the baseball team. Each day we think about what happened a year ago, and we definitely miss them. I want to take a minute to speak on behalf of my teammates and myself to thank everyone for the support that we were shown last year. So many people offered to help in any way that they could, and it meant a lot to us. To President Suarez and our campus family, thank you. Thank you for being there, for bringing us meals, Girl Scout cookies, and doing countless other things. To Larry Valentin and his office full of counselors at the ready, thank you. To our teachers for being understanding and working with us throughout the year, thank you. To Michael Morvis and everyone at Student Life, thank you. To Efren Galvin, thank you for always being there for us. And lastly, to our athletic family, Michael Sutliff, Jason Kaler, Ashley Ripien, Luis Miranda, Tony Magana, Chastity Dutro, Chaz Kakipi, and all the other coaches and athletes, thank you. Our first game and our season couldn't have happened without all of you. So thank you, and forever Pirates.
Today is Alto's favorite day, opening day. He loved opening day. And on opening day, he was always here super early. But today, I beat him to the field. And it's going to be the only time that I ever do. As you guys were walking in, you saw this is the house that Alto built. Everything you see here, Alto fundraised for, found a way to have done. It took him 28 years, and this was his dream job, and he loved every second of this job.
You will see your brother's number everywhere you look. And every time you see that number, it will make you think of him and remember him. There are a lot of 14s around here today. Every time you see the number 14, you think about John Altobelli, and you remember the man that he was.
We respect and admire the team's decision to play as scheduled, and we know that Coach Altobelli would have had no other way. We wear our school colors today, but we are today all Pirates.
Look at all these people out here today. That says a lot about my brother. That says a lot about the Pirate baseball family, and it says a lot about this community. So on behalf of my family, thank you. Thank you from the bottom of my heart. Season opener, it's baseball. It's another miserable day in Southern California. What do you say we smile for the next 3 hours and have some fun?
Hi, my name is Michael Sutliff, and I'm Dean of Kinesiology and Athletics at Orange Coast College. You know, a year ago, we lost John Altobelli, which was our beloved baseball coach and faculty member, and his death was an absolute shock to us. And so we decided to give a tribute on the annual event of his death, and it is absolutely the right thing to do, and so I'm glad we're doing that. John was a friend and a colleague and an individual that so many faculty members lived up to. He was a fantastic mentor and always willing to give everyone a helping hand. You know, two aspects of his work I'd like to highlight. The first is his teaching. I mean, he was a fantastic teacher. Loved teaching activity classes, and I know in particular I'd go visit his classes, and he would always warmly receive me and was always excited to have me in class. And after observing for a while, he, in a table tennis class, he would hand me a paddle and expect me to get out there and start playing with the students, which I absolutely took advantage of and loved to do. And through that process, I learned that the students respected John tremendously, and he really respected his students, and they really appreciated that, and they learned so much in that class, and like his other classes. As a coach, John was absolutely fantastic, and his success speaks for itself. And the one thing I want to highlight about John and how he ran that baseball program was the students and the athletes and how they acted. They were very respectful to their opponents, and even when they were doing well, and which was every year, his athletes were very respectful, whether they were hitting home runs or pulling double plays or doing incredible things on the field. His athletes didn't over embellish that, but they were humble and they were respectful to their opponents, and John reinforced the concept of, you know, act like you've been there before, and they did that every game, and they just worked so hard, and again, a testament to John. This year's been tough. It's been a challenge, and again, I'm so glad we're doing this tribute, and our thoughts and prayers as a division are going out to the family members of John Altobelli and everyone that was impacted by this tragic event. And I thank you for listening. Let's definitely keep that group in our thoughts and prayers.
John Edward Altobelli was born on May 8, 1963 in Chicago, Illinois, and was the sixth of seven children to Jim and Pat Altobelli. A few years later, the Altobellis moved to Southern California, where John began to kick off his athletic career. John was the starting shortstop and team captain for the Newport Harbor High School baseball team before graduating in 1981. A shoulder injury moved Alto to the outfield at Golden West College, where he continued his career for two seasons before moving on to play two more seasons at the University of Houston. After a brief minor league career, Altobelli changed his focus to coaching, and his first big coaching opportunity came as an assistant coach at UC Irvine for 5 years under the guidance of longtime skipper Mike Jarakas. The program was terminated in 1992, forcing Alto into looking for that next opportunity, and that opportunity came at Orange Coast College, where he replaced longtime coach Mike Main. John's first year saw the Pirates advance to the state Final Four, and from there, the Pirates earned moderate success for the first portion of his career. Alto really left his lasting legacy of winning in his final decade or so of his coaching tenure, starting in 2009 when his Pirates overcame the death of catcher Jordan Watanabe and shocked the California Community College baseball world with the first of his four state championships. That championship feeling returned to the Pirates again in 2014 when Alto led Coast to another state title. Also that year, PerfectGame.com honored OCC with a national number one ranking to end the 2014 season. In 2015, the Pirates returned to the state Final Four as a decided underdog and proceeded to successfully defend their state championship with three straight wins over the nation's top two teams. John's final season came in 2019, where he helped lead the Pirates to one of the most improbable state championships in history. Needing to win three straight games and playing four games in just over 24 hours, the Pirates pulled off the miracle with a walk-off hit in the bottom half of the ninth inning of the winner-take-all game against El Camino College to send OCC to another state championship. It would be John's final game in a Pirate uniform. In 27 seasons with the Pirates, Alto racked up 705 wins, over 300 more than any coach in OCC baseball history. In addition to the four state titles, Alto also helped the Pirates win 7 Orange Empire Conference championships during his tenure. He was named the OEC Coach of the Year 8 times and the State Coach of the Year 4 times. On 8 different occasions, his Pirate teams advanced to the state Final Four, and in his final season, Alto was recognized throughout the country when he was awarded the American Baseball Coaches Association Diamond National Coach of the Year. In addition to the legacy of his wins and losses, Alto will forever be remembered for the facility he helped create. Using incredible fundraising skills, John has literally changed everything about Wendell Pickens Field. From the new scoreboard, fencing, playing surface, bleacher area, snack bar, bathrooms, and press box, among other things. Helping to raise millions of dollars for the OCC baseball program, Wendell Pickens Field is now one of the top facilities in the nation at any baseball level. But his proudest achievements were his children. JJ, who is the scout for the Boston Red Sox, Lexi, who is finishing up high school at Newport Harbor, and Alyssa, who was about to begin her ascent into the basketball ranks before her life was cut short on that January 26 helicopter crash. Also lost that day was John's loving wife, Keri, who devoted her life to her husband and her children.
Hi, everybody. My name's Nate Johnson. I'm the head baseball coach here at Orange Coast College. Thank you for being at this virtual celebration today. I know, celebration, right? We definitely should be celebrating these three, Alto, Keri, and Alyssa, as well as everyone else that was on that helicopter. It's crazy that it's been 1 year. It still doesn't feel real. It's been a weird year, been a crazy year. Like I said, it just doesn't feel real. Sometimes when I do stuff like this and I talk about Alto, I just black out and I just start rambling. So I'm going to try not to do that. But I miss those three. I definitely miss them. And, I'm sitting in the baseball office right now. You can see his picture over my shoulder and jerseys and things. And, every day I walk in here, it's a constant reminder of what happened. And, it's a good reminder. It's special to be able to walk in here and think about the good times we had, the championships we won, the conversations we had, the relationship that I had with Alto, Keri, and Alyssa. And, no one wants to celebrate this day, but here we are. It's going to come around once a year and we're doing the best we can this year with what we have, with the pandemic going on. And, I wish I could just open the gates of the baseball field and invite, the thousands of people that we had at our first game on the 28th, 2 days after this happened. I wish we could invite them all back and, whip up some hot dogs and have a barbecue and just enjoy it and tell stories and talk about Alto and Keri and Alyssa and, obviously, hopefully next year or whenever we can do it. That's the first thing I'm doing because, the Pirate family, right? We always preach about it. We talk about it here with our program. Alto talked about it all the time. It's true. We're all one big family. Baseball team, athletics department, kinesiology department, and this school. The support that you guys gave, not only myself, but my team last year, meant the world to us, meant the world to me. So when we talk about Pirate family, we don't take it lightly. It's definitely special. It's definitely special. Alto, I have so many great memories with him. Won 3 state championships with him and countless practice hours, countless hours out here maintaining a field before we had turf. And I enjoyed every minute with him. Conversations we had, what we were able to talk about, how much he mentored me. Everyone always is like, "Hey, Nate, how are you gonna, how are you gonna fill Alto's shoes?" I'm not. he's got size 38 feet in my mind, but definitely miss him. Definitely miss him. I didn't think this video was gonna be so hard, but here I am. Keri was the ultimate coach's wife. She, the support that she gave for Alto and the support that she gave us as coaches and the team itself, she's the definition of coach's wife. She knew all the players' names. She brought us into the Pirate family. You don't have a Pirate family unless you have someone that is kind of the mama bear that holds it all together, and that's her. She held her family together. She loved her kids. She loved Alto. I had such a great relationship with her, a constant back and forth of, threading a pretty thin line to go in to make her a little frustrated, a little mad. And so I would play around with her, and it was a really nice relationship. And, Alyssa, she was getting all geared up to go play basketball. Her dream was to go to the University of Oregon, and playing on the Mambas, I have no doubt in my mind that was going to happen, that she was going to be able to fulfill that dream and more than likely go on and play further, go into the WNBA. She had an infectious laugh, an infectious smile. It was huge. I was lucky enough to go out to help Alto coach out in Cape Cod for a summer league after our 2014 season. And we all had one house, and we were all crammed in there, myself and Lexi and Lissa, there was a loft, and I was the young guy, and that was where I was. They had two beds in the corner, and I had a bed, and it was hilarious. Those two were giggling all night long, and they were trying to stay up late. And Alyssa that summer had a pet turtle that she put pink tape over and released, and Lord knows that thing's probably dead by now with the pink tape. It was just one big target. So I can tell stories all day long, right? But I definitely miss those three. It's never easy to talk about. Like I said earlier, I thank all of you guys for the support that you showed myself and this team through last year. And, again, thanks for being here. And remember Alto today, remember Keri today, remember Alyssa today, remember those that were on the helicopter today. And Alto always preached. And I'll end with this. I know I'm getting a little long, but I'll end with this in saying that, make today count. That was Alto's favorite saying, make today the best day. And I know he lived that way. He instilled it in our players. But he talked constantly about, you never know what's going to happen. Whether it's, you blow out your arm and you can't play baseball anymore, or all of a sudden you're in a helicopter crash. Make today a great day, and make every day a great day. And appreciate what you have, love your family. But more important, make today a great day. Thank you, everybody.
Hi there, everybody. My name is Tony Altobelli. I'm the Sports Information Director here at Orange Coast College, as well as the brother of John Altobelli. First and foremost, thank you so much for watching our video, our tribute today to our brother on our one-year anniversary of his passing, along with his wife, Keri, and daughter, Alyssa, and six others on that helicopter, including Kobe Bryant and his daughter, Gianna. It's been an incredible year, for lack of a better explanation. We've all gone through a year of unbelievable sadness, depression, void, confusion, all these things that you can think of, in addition to losing these people that were so important in our lives, between the social unrest and the COVID and all these things. I think everyone deserves a round of applause just for surviving and getting to where we are today. Some things I wanted to talk about in terms of John. I put the four rings up behind me today. Because I think it's kind of a cool picture. But it helps remind me of the best times that John had with Orange Coast and I had with John at Orange Coast. And there's some kind of fun stories to go with all four of them. Starting back to 2009, for those that don't know, we had an unbelievable loss that year with Jordan Watanabe. One of our players died during the season, and it was amazing. It was just to watch that team do the unthinkable, you know, and win our first state championship. Well, those that may or may not know this, John was not part of the final 16 or 17 games of the year. Norman came out one too many times, and he was suspended for the rest of the season. But kind of a funny story behind all that. At the state championship, you know, John was allowed to be there, but he wasn't allowed to be on the grounds or anything during the game. So he would go down the line, all over the fence, and just kind of peek in through a hole like a kid trying to sneak into a ballpark. And when it got to the championship games, we lost the first game of the championship final, which means we had to play again for a winner take all kind of deal. So Keri, in all of her superstitious wit, was under the conclusion that because the girls' outfits weren't proper or weren't OCC enough or whatever the deal was, she thought that was the voodoo that caused it. So she wanted to change uniforms for the girls before the next game. Well, you know, we're all packed up. We're in suitcases and all that. So she unzips her suitcase, puts on new clothes, and she starts zipping the bag back up. And there was something sharp sticking out of the suitcase. I'm not sure exactly what it was. I heard tweezers, something, but it sliced her hand pretty much from here to here. And to remember John, blood was not one of his favorite things in the world. So I'm standing right next to John when Carrie's doing this, and he turns white as a ghost and almost passes out just from the sight of blood. Right. So he takes Keri over to the trainer. The trainer looks at it and says, "That's not a Band-Aid. That's stitches. Go to, you know, Fresno Memorial Hospital, whatever it's called." So John's telling me, "You got to send me messages. You got to send me updates. You got to let me know every half inning." I'm like, "Well, John, I'm working. You know, I'm doing the announcing. I'm doing the music. I'm doing a scoreboard. It's, you know, I was doing the same jobs at Coast, but at Fresno City College." And says, "I'll do the best I can." So we got out to a big lead. Delta College crept back into it. And then by the time it was the ninth inning, we had I think it was a 10-7 lead. John came back in time for it and was able to see the last inning. And it was beautiful. You know, he's in street clothes. He snuck behind the field, behind the dugout for the last three outs with Jordan's father, Kent. Love you to death. And that's there's video on YouTube that's absolutely awesome, so check that out if you can. So that was a good story from 2009. 2014, which is this ring right here, we were just good. You know, we were a really good team. They ended up being number one in the nation. It was just a special group. But even that team, there was a period of the season where things were a little bit ragged. They weren't playing the best as they could play. And John and I, we were kind of joking about, you know, what can we do to snap these guys out of it? And it was right around April Fool's time, you know, and I kind of jokingly said, "Well, we could have an April Fool's fight." He's like, "What do you mean?" I'm like, "Well, what if you and I just get into a fight? You know, well, I'll say something smarmy, you tell me to blank off, and we start shoving and let's roll, you know, let's see what happens." And then just get up and say, "Ha ha, April Fool's to everybody." But John goes, "All right, let's get through this game. And if we struggle again today, then we'll talk about it," you know? So funny thing is they won that game. So John, being superstitious, like every baseball player in the world, is like, "All right, well, let's wait till we lose, you know, and then we'll do this," you know? And we start pretending choreography and all these kinds of things. Well, sure enough, they end up winning every single game the rest of the year. They won 15 straight to end the season. And became the state champion. And I remember giving him a hug after that game. And I said, "Looks like we're not fighting, are we?" And he started laughing. So that's a good memory for me on that one. The team back here, the 2015 team, is the team that should not have won a state championship. You know, there was nothing but good players on that 14 team. They were all gone, you know, and there was a few good ones left for 15, but that was a team that just, you know, let's just get to the playoffs, have some fun and see what happens. And that's exactly what happened with that group. They won. They were on the road for all three rounds of the playoffs, won two out of three on the last two to do it, including losing the first game, then winning the next two to get to Fresno. And I'll never forget it. The gentleman that runs the state championship went to John before the tournament started and congratulated John, obviously, on getting there. The other three teams were really, really good. They were, you know, I think the number one team in the nation, the number two team in the nation, I think the number four team in the nation. And we were 35th or whatever it was, you know, we were just happy to be there kind of deal. And the gentleman went to John and said, well, it looks like we're going to have another national championship coming out of this tournament like we did last year. And John looks at him. He's like, what do you mean? He's like, well, you know, the number one team, the number two team, the number four team, I'm sure that, you know, anything could happen. John just kind of looks at him and he's like, so you don't think we have a shot at winning this thing, you know? And the guy's, oh no, that's not what I meant. That's not what I meant at all. He's like, ah, no, it's okay. I understand what you mean. Thanks, buddy. And he grabbed every player and went down the right field line and just gave the greatest pep talk you could ever have in a pep talk. You know, it was the kind of thing that I wish I had a glove and a bat and shoes. I was ready to go. I was ready to take the field that day. So sure enough, take on the number one team in the nation, beat them, game one. Number two team in the nation, beat them. Went to game three, had to play the number one team again, beat them, and won the state championship with a team, like I said, that just played with a lot of heart and a lot of determination, and that was a special group. And then obviously the big daddy over here, this 2019 one, kind of a fun story. One of my best friends is the radio, or the TV play-by-play announcer for the Vegas Golden Knights named Dave Gosher. And he was a radio announcer for the Bruins. And he was there when they won a Stanley Cup in 2011, I believe it was. And he has his ring and he's always proud to show the ring. And I brought this bad boy to Vegas. And I wanted to see if my ring was actually bigger or taller or wider than his was. And sure enough, it is. And is it the same value? Absolutely not. You know, his is like $21,000 and mine's not. So anyway, sidebar story on that one. But, you know, there's so many things that happened in the 2019 Final Four that, you know, I'll never forget. Things that didn't happen in the other three that I guess, for lack of a better term, somebody upstairs knew something was going to happen. And it gave me memories that I'll never forget, you know. And I think one of my favorite ones is after we won the whole thing, you know, they do the team photo at the end with the scoreboard in the background. And I was just standing there and I noticed John was in the lower left-hand corner. And I've been in all four pitchers. I was lucky enough to be there for all four of them. And for whatever reason, John and I were never sitting next to each other or standing next to each other, just because that's just how it was. Well, this time he was in the lower left-hand corner. I'm just kind of standing there. I'm like, all right, I'll pop in there. And I put my knee down. I put my arm around him. I'm like, hey, you mind? And he goes, I'd love it. Put his arm around me and gave me a good grip on my shoulder that I'll never forget. It wasn't just a dangling arm over your shoulder. It was a, hey, I'm glad you're here. You know, thanks for being a part of this. And I'll never forget it. So, you know, John's last time ever on a baseball field with me, I have a picture to remember it by, and that's something I'll never forget. And the day before all this happened, my favorite story of this whole thing was I was actually trying to work out the day before this all happened, and I was at Orange Coast running the track and going up and down the stadium stairs, you know, pre-COVID days, and I heard baseball bats and balls and ding 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 going off, so I ran it over to the field. And John was just sitting there watching the game in his usual stoop. And I stood behind him and he's like, what are you doing here? It's Saturday. Like, are you lost or something? And I said, you're not going to believe it, John. I was just working out, you know. And John like looked back up at me like, are you kidding me? Like, you know, and everyone giggling and laughing, is, you know, big brother to little brother. I said, John, I just did 15 laps around the track. I did 15 up and down stadium stairs. And he followed that up with something to the effect of, yeah, now you're going to have, you know, 15 beers and 15 pieces of pizza afterward. And everyone started laughing. Well, nobody noticed, but he turned around and he didn't turn around. He reached behind without even looking at me, looked straight at the field and kind of squeezed my leg like, you know, good job. Like, no one else is going to know I'm proud of you, but here's a little leg squeeze to let you know that I'm proud of you. And so that was nice. And I caught the last, I don't know, 20 minutes of practice or so, and everything's done. I'm about to walk out, and I did something I've never done. I never did before. And obviously I'll never do again. I walked, you know, John and I are walking like this, and I just kind of, I gave him one of these, which I've never done. And I said, I'll see you on Tuesday. And John's like, okay, Joe, see you Tuesday. And Kent Watanabe, you know, one of our assistant coaches, he said to me, he's like, you know, Toad, I don't know if you heard, but all the parents were here for the inner squad. And before the game, John talked about you to all of them. And I said, all right, cool. You know, what do you have to say? You know, waiting for some zinger, right? And he goes, he said that you're one of the best SIDs in the state. And I'm like, oh, that's nice, you know. And sure enough, John comes running out. He goes, that's not what I said. That's not what I said. And I'm like, okay, what do you got? You know, and he looked me dead in the eye and he said, I said, you're the best sports information director in the state. And I thought that was really nice. And it turns out, unfortunately, that was the last thing I heard from him, you know. So incredible guy, you know, we all know this. It's been a year. We've all talked about him. We all have the memories. We all have the stories. Mine go a little bit, you know, deeper for family reasons. I miss him to death. I miss him every day. I talk about him every day. People ask about me, about him every day. And it's a story I never get tired of talking about, you know, especially this week, you know, the people, the TVs and the radios, and the newspapers are suddenly finding me popular again. And I have no problem for the most part talking about it. It's nice. It's wonderful that his memory is never going to be forgotten. And, you know, it's painful. You have to get through it. And I hope this video helps other people get through it, because that's what John would want. You know, John would say enough's enough. Like, let's move on and let's love life and live life and hug each other and tell everyone we love each other and share wonderful stories and wonderful memories. And I know that's exactly what we're going to do when we're allowed to get back on campus again. I can't wait to spend the rest of my career at Orange Coast, keeping John's memory, alive, you know, and telling stories and, just doing whatever I can, to help out all of our programs, be successful. But obviously, I have a special spot in my heart for my brother, and I love him to death. And, Keri and Alyssa, we miss you to death too. And, it's painful. But you know, without pain, you don't have love. So, you know, I'm grateful for that as well. So thank you. Thank you for listening to my little speech here. And, before I go, I know I'm kind of the last one to speak here. So on behalf of everybody, part of this video, you know, special thanks to Kevin Holder, to Juan Gutierrez, and everyone in the marketing and PR department. You guys did a great job, helping us put this thing together. We couldn't do this without you, obviously. So thank you so much for that. For everyone that was involved in our video today, Nate Johnson, Jason Kaler, Ashley Ripien, Michael Sutliff, President Suarez, thank you. Thank you so much for just wanting to take the time and the energy and the effort to make this as good as it can be. And, you know, everyone that's contributed photos, and videos and just has been there to tell funny stories. And, I can't tell you what that does for everybody involved here. It's a blessing. So thank you so much. And, before I lose it here, on behalf of my family and on behalf of everybody, involved with Orange Coast College, thank you. We could not have gotten through this year without you. Your stories, your memories. Thank you. It's all I can say. The world looks terrible on TV sometimes, but over the year I've learned that there is so much love and so many wonderful people in this world. I can't thank you guys enough. We could not have made it without you guys. So thank you. And I'll end with a quote I heard today from our brand new president, Joe Biden. He said something effective: to heal, you must remember. And it's hard sometimes to remember, but that's how you heal. So thank you guys very much. And we miss you all, John, Keri, and Alyssa. Thank you.